been telling you guys that I, as an ex-McKinsey consultant, nowadays work as an independent management advisor. And I thought it is time to show you how a week in the life as a self-employed consultant can look like. Does it look like this? We will find out, as I will take you through a real independent consultant work week of a project I've concluded recently. I'm Jack and spent 5 years as a McKinsey consultant and project manager before setting up my own business as a freelance consultant. Here on You and Consulting, I share my business and consulting insider advice with you, and I make sure it's worth it for you to hit that subscribe button. Let me start with the prequel to the project. I work as a self-employed management consultant in the sense that I do not only execute consulting projects, but also acquire them, either alone or with business partners together. So we find new clients and convince them to run performance improvement projects with us, which is the same job that usually consulting firm partners do. By the way, if you are interested in leaving your consulting firm job and do not yet know how to start as a self-employed freelance consultant, happily get in touch with me and bookmark this video. For this particular project I want to talk to you about, the story began about a year ago when a business partner and I were about to win a new client in Eastern Europe. But as you all know, unfortunately a war broke out in the region and the project discussed was called off. Less than a year later though, the prospective client remembered us and asked us for help with a similar project. Our client is a private equity investment company that was considering to purchase a cement plant in Eastern Europe. Okay, it actually wasn't a cement plant, but a raw materials production plant. For confidentiality reasons, let me refer to it as a cement plant. Our client asked us for help with a so-called technical due diligence. In case you're not aware of what a due diligence is, in a nutshell, before an investor decides to buy a new asset, it will run a thorough assessment of the target company to ensure that the investment is a good idea and to determine the price it is willing to pay. In our case, our client wanted to run a financial due diligence, a tax due diligence, and a technical due diligence. A financial due diligence is often run by a top consulting firm such as McKinsey. The tax due diligence is often covered by a Big Four company. In this project, we were asked to run the technical due diligence for them. What is that? Well, imagine you want to buy a used car and are not sure if the information the seller provides you with in their technical summary sheet is correct. Then you would potentially hire an engineer to help you with the technical checkup. That exactly was the job we got asked for, send a technical expert team and check if the cement plant lived up to what was promised in the seller's sales offer leaflet. Due diligences always take place in a very hectic context. The seller usually negotiates with multiple potential buyers and tight deadlines are set for all potential buyers to submit their offers. In the 2 weeks before our project started, my role was to convince our prospective client that we would get the job done well and to develop a compelling project proposal. Meanwhile, my business partner was busy putting together a suitable technical expert team, which was very challenging since this particular cement plant ran with a very specific configuration. Truth to be told, our project was confirmed on a Saturday, the day before my birthday party, for which day I had planned a large and happy gathering. What did I do when we received the project confirmation? Well, I celebrated my birthday nevertheless, and in the evening made my luggage to fly out the very next morning. Which brings us to a week in my life as an ex-McKinsey freelance consultant. Day 1, Monday. On Monday morning, I took a plane from Hamburg Airport, Germany, to Istanbul, where I changed planes to go to the final destination in Eastern Europe. If you believe I was watching movies on the planes, I must disappoint you. Our client had opened their virtual data room for us the day before. That meant I spent the entire day on the trains and planes opening and closing each and every file of the 400 plus documents we were provided with to pre-filter which ones may be important and which ones we could discard immediately. By midnight, I sent a data inventory summary to our client in which I explained which further technical data we would desperately need to successfully run the technical due diligence. My request was for our client to lobby the seller of the plant to order his teams to immediately release these additional data. My business partner and I had coordinated our team of 5 to meet during the transit at Istanbul Airport, but the available flight connections had been abysmal, and we reached our final destination and hotel at 3:30 a.m. in the morning. Day 2, Tuesday. Listen, guys, for those of you who currently work at the top management consulting firm such as McKinsey, BCG or Bain, as an employed consultant, you would nevertheless be expected to come into office the next morning by 9 a.m. at the latest. As a team of freelance consultants, we leveraged our freedom and agreed to meet the next day 8 hours later at 11:30 a.m. On Tuesday, we indulged in the luxury of spending one day together in a hotel conference room for the team kickoff. Some of us had not yet met each other in person before, and my business partner and I needed to set up the network drives and familiarize everybody with the most relevant project documents. Besides helping to acquire the project, my role on the project was to manage the project and team, as well as the interactions with our client and the plant management. However, I did not own the technical knowledge, so I was making sure to sit down with each of our 3 technical experts to learn. Most importantly, we needed to align everybody on the objectives of our plant visit, given we had only very little time on the ground. For each plant area, we defined which technical information we had to validate or disprove. And if you like to validate my channel, hit the like and subscribe buttons for further top quality business and consulting career advice. Day 3, Wednesday. The third project day was the most critical day of the entire project. We met the seller's plant management team for the first time. I would like to make you aware that this has been a very delicate project setup. Our client, the potential buyer, whom we never met in person, sent us to the plant up for sale. The seller, whom we never talked to directly, commanded his plant management team to welcome us and answer all our questions to our and our client's satisfaction. The poor plant management team then has to fulfill the same duty to all buyer teams visiting and actually a plant to run. This setup is different from a traditional consulting project where we would gain insights and then immediately share our recommendations with the plant management. Here, we were appointed to suck out the information from a plant management team, but we are not allowed to feedback our advice. I therefore expected a somewhat hostile atmosphere, so when addressing the CEO and his team, I did my best to make us appear come in a friendly mission. To my great relief, the management team was very professional and did what it had been asked to do. I made sure to immediately communicate all required data requests. We decided to spend the first day in the plant together with the entire team to gain initial impressions. We were shown around by the chief engineer of the plant, and now it was the time for our technical experts to shine. Working side by side with our highly experienced senior experts is a humbling experience. As a project manager, you are responsible for running the show, but the expert team members are the masters of the content. The plant management team was impressed with the expertise of our technical experts, and by the evening we had all warmed up with each other. Then the CEO proved to be a great host and treated the entire team for a lavish traditional dinner at a special venue. This was a project highlight. I was sitting opposite to the CEO and next to the chief engineer. I always like to talk private matters with my clients, and the chief engineer mentioned to me over dinner that his father was seriously ill. Day 4, Thursday. The next morning we reconvened in the plant's boardroom and I was shocked. The CEO announced that yesterday night the chief engineer's father had passed away. The chief engineer had spent the previous evening with us for a very nice but business dinner while his father was lying on the deathbed. Besides my personal shock, this also implied a serious risk for the project. The CEO had to commission his deputy chief engineer and the head of sales instead to show us around the plant premises. Furthermore, my data request had lied with the chief engineer, so would it be processed now? Of course, there are more important things in life than that. This day, my business partner and I split up and joined our expert teams in different areas of the plant. We took pictures of all major plant areas, unfortunately confidential ones, and interviewed different members of staff, often with the help of a translator. When you run a due diligence, you need to understand the status quo of a plant, but you also need to develop initial ideas on how the performance of a plant can be improved, because improvement options the seller has not yet leveraged himself make the purchase of the asset even more attractive to the buyer. By the way, visiting the plant was a highly interesting experience, since it partially looked as if the time had stood still for a while in there. Some areas of the plant looked like some museum-like relics of the Sovietian area. I wish I could show you some more pictures, but the entire project was highly confidential, so This is as bad as we can get. In the evening, we declined any dinner invites and debriefed internally on the second plant visit day. Day 5, Friday. The day 5, Friday, had been a local bank holiday, but we had repeatedly made the point that returning to the plant for a third time would significantly help to improve the quality of our insights, so we were admitted to the premises for a third time and could finish our screening. On that day, our host insisted on taking us for lunch to another good restaurant for more delicious local food. In the afternoon, I decided to send a message to the chief engineer who had lost his father. I felt compelled to do so just to express my compassion. To my great surprise, though, the chief engineer not only thanked me for my note, but insisted to send me the requested data as soon as possible. I received them the same evening. To me, that was another proof that often acting like a human being and not like a robot gets you farthest in consulting life. Day 6, Saturday. What, day 6? Time to go home at last, no? Well, at McKinsey you would only work on weekends if something in your running project went seriously wrong, and you should not have to do so. However, my business partner and I were our own bosses, and we thought before the team disbands into all directions, it would be more efficient to keep it together for a bit more time. Given it was a weekend day, we would take it a bit easier though. I hit a fantastic hotel gym before joining the team room, but then the responsibility to make the project a success had been back on me. I had drafted the structure of our technical due diligence report before, but now it was about making sure that our technical experts would bring their findings into this common coherent order. Furthermore, while our experts were all strong in their respective fields, they are not necessarily all equally talented in documenting their findings. In the afternoon, we eventually got to see the city in which we had been based for a week. The CEO of the cement plant had arranged a local tour guide for us for a little city tour. For the evening, my business partner had arranged a luxurious restaurant for a wonderful team dinner, which improved the great team atmosphere even more. Day 7, Sunday. On Sunday, we continued the process of setting up our technical due diligence report together, which had been due by the end of the following week. In the afternoon though, everybody was about to embark on their return flights. Well, everybody but me, who had decided to stay at least for another week in the foreign country. The second project week. During the second week, I was processing the draft inputs from our experts for our report, reviewing and editing and calling them for clarifications. Needless to say, our client called us during the middle of a week and introduced another twist to our project. I would love telling you what the twist and the outcome of the project were about, but I'm afraid I had to decide to hold that back from you for confidentiality reasons. Eventually, I decided to stay abroad for a further couple of weeks and was very busy completing this piece of work that is now available to you. Check it out. I hope you liked this insider report on how life as a freelance consultant can play out, and share your reflections in the comments. Maybe you also noticed that the main difference to a project as a McKinsey, BCG or Bain consultant is that, as an independent management advisor, you still are accountable to your client and need to hold your team together, but you are free from the shackles of corporate policy that exist even within the top management consulting firms. You do not need to impress some consulting firm partner, but just your clients. If you are currently working as an employed consultant and got intrigued by the prospect of transitioning into a freelance consulting career, take a look at my playlist dedicated to help you explore this idea. If you'd like to brainstorm with me about it or seek help with your initial steps, just hit me up on LinkedIn or by email. Talk soon, Jack.